So what we saw in previous lecture, we changed our PFR equation to a first order equation of the form dc by dv equal to minus 1 by 2 c to the power 1. Instead of 1.25, we changed it to c to the power 1. Okay. When we chose, and again starting with c at 0 equal to c 0 equal to 1 unit moles per liter, moles per meter cube, whatever that the appropriate unit might be, we started at that. Okay. We solved this particular problem you at h equal to 1 and we got a stable solution. The solution was not very accurate using the Euler's method, but at least the solution was stable. We got concentration C at 5 as some finite value. Okay. Next, what we did was we increased the h to h equal to 2. Okay. When we increased the h to h equal to 2, C0 was equal to 1. C1 we immediately saw was became equal to 0, and after that it remained at 0. Okay. C2, C4 and so on were all equal to 0 for h equal to 2. So what we saw for what we saw happening with h equal to 1 was something of this sort. Okay, what we saw happening at h equal to 2 was in one step itself, the solution came to 0 and then it stabilized at 0. Okay. Next, we considered a higher h, h equal to 2.1. At h equal to 2.1, what happened is C 2.1 was negative, C 4.2 was positive, and so on and so forth. So what we saw is we saw some amount of oscillations taking place in this particular system. Specifically, when we plot concentration versus volume, what we observed was that the concentration drops and then finally reaches 0. Okay. So this is what we saw, and these oscillations for h equal to 2.1 were relatively small. They got damped and very quickly the final solution stabilized. Then we increase the h further and we increase the h to h equal to 4. Okay. At h equal to 4, we saw C4 equal to minus 1, C8 that we observed was equal to 1, C12 was minus 1, C16 was 1, so on and so forth. So what we had observed in that particular case was behavior of this type. Okay. So each alternate values was negative or positive, so on and so forth. Okay. That is the behavior that we saw for at h equal to 4. And finally, when we increase from h equal to 4 to h equal to 5, I think we increase it to h equal to 5, okay, but any value greater than 4 will suffice. What happened was that C5, C10, C20 and so on started increasing, and finally the concentration just blew up. So if we were to plot this particular guy for h equal to 5, we'll actually see a plot of this type. Okay, so what we see is that this guy keeps expanding and we'll either reach plus infinity or minus infinity alternatively as volume V tends to infinity. Okay, so this is what we saw with Euler's explicit method. Okay, so what happens over here in this range is that the solution converges monotonically. Keep in mind that this is a plug flow reactor. This is in physically in a plug flow reactor, the concentration cannot go in a fluctuating manner. It has to actually smoothly go to the final steady state. That is what we will physically observe in a plug flow reactor in which a first order in which actually any reaction any single reaction is taking place. Okay. The next case was when H was between 2 and 4. Between 2 and 4, what we saw was there were oscillations. Okay. And when H was increased beyond 4, we saw that the system was unstable. Okay. We will now go ahead and analyze this behavior for the Euler's explicit method, try to find out why we get this particular type of a behavior, and then we will extend the same analysis to the Euler's implicit method. Okay. So, I will go back over here where I had initially written down the expression for Euler's implicit and Euler's explicit methods. We will now look at the Euler's implicit method. The equation that we started off with was of the form dy by dt equal to minus lambda y, okay, where lambda in this particular example was half. Okay. So, now if we want to solve this particular equation analytically, we divide throughout by y and we take dt on the other side and we integrate, and we will get ln of y equal to minus lambda t plus constant c. At t equal to 0, we have y equal to y 0. So, the constant c is going to be equal to ln of y 0. Okay, and we just rearrange this and we will get y at any time t equal to y 0 e to the power minus lambda t. Okay. Now, exponential function is always going to be stable, limit as t tends to infinity e to the power minus lambda t is going to tend to 0 for positive values of lambda. So, the analytical solution is stable for lambda greater than 0, okay. Plus the behavior of the exponential function e to the power minus lambda t with t is going to look somewhat like this, okay, which basically means, and finally it should settle down at 0, it would not go below 0. This is the function y against t starting at value y 0. Okay. So, what we will see, so the two physical features of the analytical solution of this particular equation is one, that the equation settles down to t to y equal to 0, and its second thing is it settles down monotonically provided lambda is greater than 0. If lambda is less than 0, of course, we are going to get an unstable solution. Now, what we want from our numerical method is, the first thing is that the numerical method of our choice should converge to a value. What it means by it should converge to a value is that limit as I tends to infinity or limit as t tends to infinity, y should converge to a finite value. This is of course true only if we have the original analytical equation being stable. We are just considering those cases for now. Okay. So, we want the value of yi to be equal to a finite value as I tends to infinity. Okay. So, let us look at the explicit method first. Okay. So, we will have yi plus 1 equal to yi plus h times f of yi comma ti. Okay. And the function f in this particular case is minus lambda y. Okay. So, f of yi comma ti when we substitute over here is going to be minus lambda multiplied by yi. Okay. So, we can write this as 1 minus lambda h multiplied by yi. Okay. So, yi plus 1 is 1 minus lambda h multiplied by yi. Okay, that is what we get. So, now this we can write it as 1 minus lambda h multiplied by yi multiplied by yi minus 1. So, we will have this as 1 minus lambda h squared yi minus 1 which we can write it as 1 minus lambda h cubed yi minus 2 and so on equal to 1 minus lambda h to the power I plus 1 multiplied by y 0. Okay. Now, this is our value of yi. Now, let us consider the three cases, the case where yi decreased monotonically, the case where yi had oscillations, and the third case where yi did not have any oscillations, but yi had oscillations, but it was unstable. Okay. So, the case of monotonic decrease is when we get yi behavior something like this, and with yi ending at y equal to 0 as I increases. Okay. For this to happen, okay, what we need is that 1 minus lambda h should actually lie between minus 1 and plus 1, okay, that is required for stability, and this particular guy should be positive, that is required for monotonicity. Okay. So, for this particular thing is that let us call the 1 minus lambda h as alpha, for yi plus 1, or rather yi equal to alpha to the power I multiplied by y 0. For this particular equation to be monotonic, we need alpha to be less than 1 and greater than 0. This is what the alpha should satisfy in order for this particular equation to stabilize monotonically. Okay. For us to observe some oscillations, but not a lot, whole lot of oscillations, okay, if let us say if alpha was equal to minus half, what we will get is y 1 equal to minus half multiplied by y 0. So, y 0 starts at 1, this becomes minus 0.5. Okay. Next, y 2 is minus half multiplied by y 1, and y 1 is minus 0.5. So, y 2 becomes plus 0.25, y 3 becomes minus 0.125, y 4 becomes minus 0.0625, plus 0.0625, so on and so forth. So, for this behavior, we need alpha to be between minus 1 less than alpha less than 0, or actually I should be writing as equal to. When alpha is equal to 0, at that time we immediately will hit this particular value and then flatten out at y equal to 0. Okay. And for the case where we get oscillation, for the case where we get instability, okay, we need alpha to be greater than the absolute value of alpha to be greater than 1. Okay. That means alpha should be less than minus 1 or alpha should be greater than minus 1. Okay. So, these are the various three conditions, and let us evaluate the first two conditions now. Let us evaluate the first condition where 0 should be less than equal to alpha, should be less than 1. And we substitute alpha equal to 1 minus lambda h. So, we will have 0 less than equal to 1 minus lambda h less than 1, okay, or we can take 1 on this side, and we will get this as minus 1, and this will become 0. Okay. So, we will have minus 1 less than equal to minus lambda h less than 0, okay, or 0 less than lambda h less than equal to 1. Okay. So, as long as h, now h is a positive quantity, so this becomes a redundant thing. Okay. H we always know is going to be positive. So, as long as the value of h is less than equal to 1 by lambda, we will get monotonic behavior. Okay. So, that is the first result, that the overall numerical solution of the Euler's explicit method is going to be monotonic and monotonically decreasing for a linear system as long as h is less than or equal to 1 by lambda. Okay. Now let us then consider the next question. When do we get oscillations? We get oscillations we'll get oscillatory but stable behavior if alpha is less than 0 and less than minus 1, okay. That means minus 1 less than 1 minus lambda h less than 0, or minus 2 less than negative lambda h less than minus 1, okay. Or 1 less than lambda h less than 2, or h should lie between 1 by lambda and 2 by lambda, okay. So if h is between 1 over lambda and 2 over lambda, we will get the system to be stable but oscillatory. Okay. If h is negative, we will get the system to be unstable. If h is greater than 2 by lambda, we will get the system to be unstable again. Okay. If h is greater than 2 by lambda, we will not only get the system to be unstable, in addition to being the system being unstable, we will also see oscillations. So system is both oscillatory and unstable. Okay. So to summarize these results, okay. So summary for of stability results for Euler's explicit method is that if h lies between 0 and 1 by lambda, we will get monotonic and stable behavior. If h lies between 1 by lambda and 2 by lambda, we will get a stable though oscillatory behavior. If h is greater than 2 by lambda, we will get an unstable behavior. Okay. So I will start with 0 over here. I will put a point, a location 1 by lambda, put another location 2 by lambda, and then these are the values greater than that. If h lies in the red region, we have stable and monotonic behavior. If h lies in this yellow region, we have stable but oscillatory behavior. Okay. And if h lies beyond this, we have unstable behavior. Okay. So let us go to the result of the previous lecture. In this particular case, lambda was equal to half. So 1 by lambda is 2 and 2 by lambda is 4. Okay. Between 0 and 2, we get stable and monotonic behavior. Between 2 and 4, we get stable but oscillatory behavior. At 4, we get exactly oscillatory behavior. The oscillations do not increase, they do not dampen, they keep going like this, because when h equal to 4, we get our alpha value, that is 1 minus lambda h, is going to be exactly equal to minus 1. Okay. As a result, y I is going to be minus 1 to the power I multiplied by y 0. So, it is going to be y 0, negative y 0, it will keep switching between those values. That is exactly what we had observed through our numerical simulations in the previous lecture. And when h went above the value of 4, for example, when we took h equal to 5, what we observed was that the Euler's explicit method was unstable. Okay. So, that summarizes the stability results for Euler's explicit method. Similar stability results are applicable for most other explicit methods, for all other explicit methods also. Explicit methods have a limit on the step size h that you can use before the system becomes unstable. Okay. If you take a very large step size using the explicit method, we will have the system becoming unstable. In case of RK2 method, the stability envelope for explicit RK2 methods are similar to that we see for the Euler's method. When we go to RK3 method, the stability envelope is much larger compared to the Euler's explicit method. In RK4 method, the stability envelope is still larger. Okay. However, in all these cases, there is a maximum value of h which depends on the value of lambda. If you go to a value of h which goes beyond that particular value, we will get this behavior of the numerical solution to be unstable. Unstable behavior of numerical solution has to be avoided at all costs for a system that we know to be stable. Okay. Now, this is where the implicit methods become useful. So, let us go back to our derivation that we had done for the Euler's explicit method. So, this is the derivation for the Euler's explicit method. I will repeat the derivation for Euler's implicit method. For Euler's implicit method, okay, for Euler's implicit method, we had yi plus 1 equal to yi plus h times f of yi plus 1. Okay, and f of yi plus 1 is nothing but negative lambda multiplied by yi plus 1. Okay. So, we will go over here and write that down. Okay. And we will take this term onto the right hand side and we will get 1 plus lambda h multiplied by yi plus 1 equal to yi, which is going to give us yi plus 1 equal to 1 divided by 1 plus lambda h multiplied by yi. Okay. So, this is the value of alpha. Okay. Now, we know that for positive values of lambda, the analytical solution is stable. So, we are only going to consider positive values of lambda. The step size is always positive. Okay. So, no matter what value of h we choose, any non-zero value of h that we choose over here, alpha value is definitely going to be 1 divided by 1 plus some positive number, which means that alpha is always going to lie between 0 and 1. In this particular case, for lambda greater than 0, alpha is guaranteed to lie between 0 and 1. Okay. No matter what value of h you choose, we know for sure that alpha will lie between 0 and 1, because alpha will lie between 0 and 1. This method, an implicit Euler's method, is what we call as globally stable. Okay. So, no matter what value of h you choose, no matter how large a value of h we choose, we will always get the implicit Euler's method to be stable. Stability does not say anything about accuracy. So, this stability property is the reason why the implicit methods are actually used. Now, what I have done so far is I have talked about the various Euler's method, Runge-Kutta method and so on. we have discussed about accuracy of those methods, we have discussed about stability of these methods, we have discussed then predictor corrector methods, what we mean by predictor corrector methods, we have also looked at non self starting methods. Okay. So, this is what we have done so far.